Welcome back to the Heroes of the Storm North American Regionals. It is very, very exciting here, folks. We're glad you're joining us. We're broadcasting live from the ESL Studios in Burbank, California, where we are about to crown our champions for North America who will represent us moving into the finals in Korea in April. I'm Anna Prosser Robinson. I'm so stoked to be sharing this here with you. Let's go over what's at stake today. First off, there is some prize money on the line. Let's look at our prize pool. It is $100,000. That first place team will take home $25,000 of those dollars. But as you can see, the teams are already in the money. Everyone goes home with a little bit. And remember, also, the seeding helps them take home more money in Korea, so that first place spot is very well desired. Now, let's take a look at the brackets. Let's see who is in the running to represent us in the finals. We are going to have Team Noventic taking on Kognitiv, who we just saw advance out of Group B. But first, we're going to watch a well-known matchup. It's Cloud9 versus Tempo Storm. I could not be more excited to start watching these matches, guys, and I know you are as well, so please let us know on social media by tweeting with the hashtag HGC. I'm getting a little bit of deja vu because it's time to introduce two teams that you know very, very well. First, let's bring them on stage. It's Cloud9.
Cloud9 with an addition of Arthlon as he trips there, doing a really good job in this tournament. Arthlon, formal teammate of KO and Soldier on Tempo Storm. This rivalry of Cloud9 versus Tempo Storm is really cool.
Cloud9 advancing over Team Blaze to make it here the top seed coming out of their group, which means they will be only with two losses here throughout this entire qualification period. Most played Cursed Hollow, likely to see that once again from these guys.
Rip.
Cloud9 did manage to beat out this next team for the North American title last year, but this year, it's all up for grabs. Let's welcome their challenger, Tempo Storm.
Tempo Storm, very new roster, with the two at the front being the only two returning from 2015 roster, KO and Soldier leading that charge. Really excited to see these two titans face off.
Man, Tempo Storm has made it here. They've made it to the semis, one step away from Korea, but it has been a tough road for them. Every match versus Panda Global, versus Team Noventic, and King of Blades Alpha went to game three to get here.
These teams don't just want that first place for the money. They want it because they want to represent their entire region. And only one of these teams after this match will have that chance. We have the advantage of knowing a lot about how these two teams work. Gilly and Zoya, can you tell us about the draft?
Absolutely, Anna. I am so excited for these two guys to face off. Not only are these guys scrim partners, but like we talked about, Arthlon, former teammates of KO and Soldier. These guys are all good friends, and not only rivals, but they really like each other, like hanging out with each other. So I'm super excited for this set, Gilly.
I'm really excited for it, too. It is the first semifinal match of the day, and I just missed what
Towers
the map is going to be. Towers of Doom.
Of course, it's Towers of Doom. If Tempo Storm's playing, it's Towers of Doom. At Heroes Rising, Tempo Storm busted out Towers of Doom versus Cloud9. They played that Vikings playstyle on it, and they got a win with it.
And yeah, we saw that earlier too versus
yes.
King of Blades Alpha. And once again, KO looked so strong on those Vikings. It made it so difficult for King of Blades to be able to respond to that. I think it's likely we will see the ban on those from Cloud9, especially since that's a known style that they hate dealing with.
Absolutely. They don't like those abusive styles that involve split pushing, soaking. That's always been kind of a crippling effect for Cloud9. You know, even back when the promote meta was a thing, they struggled so much during that period of time just because they don't like playing against that playstyle, and they refuse to run it. They just hate it.
Yeah, it makes perfect sense. It's so frustrating to deal with. You're constantly responding to just every single lane, always. Even when you win fights, you have to go back sometimes and defend your base. So I think we'll likely see that ban there. Hopefully, Tempo Storm then have something else up their sleeve besides the Vikings play here on Towers.
Oh, absolutely. Tempo Storm's not going to be able to cheese Cloud9 out of this set. They have to have something else. They have to be able to play standard. And Cloud9, you know, they've been prepared. They've known that there's always been a chance of them playing Tempo Storm. And if they were not prepared to play on Towers of Doom, they would have banned it out. So if they let Towers of Doom through the maps, they have a way to play against it.
We'll be getting into that draft very soon, but this is a storied rivalry between these two teams. All of 2015 in North America, it was Cloud9 and Tempo Storm meeting up in the finals. Now they find themselves against each other in the semifinals, and only one can go on. Only one from this best of three will be able to make it to Korea.
This is a huge thing for these guys. I mean, like you said, they made top four, which guarantees each of these teams at $15,000.
Wow.
That's such a huge thing for these guys, but they want Korea. They want Korea more than anything, and there it is, Cloud9 out the gate, banning Vikings.
Respecting KO's Vikings play, and a quick ban on Zeratul as well. iDream's Zeratul play has been very scary to deal with for other teams.
Li Ming going to be the first pick here for Cloud9, changing it up. Most teams in this situation first pick the Rhaegar, but they're going to go for that burst damage from Li Ming. I believe it's K1 Pro and Arthlon who tend to play that hero for Cloud9.
So Rhaegar is up for grabs. Also, with Li Ming being picked up, the scare potential for getting Jaina banned against you in the next phase would mean that Tempo Storm wouldn't have one of those high burst mage heroes, especially with Kael'thas not being picked up at all in this tournament.
Next two picks here for Tempo Storm. They are going to get that Rhaegar. Zix has had some very impressive ancestral healings throughout this tournament. One, I believe he told me that he had 40-something HP in that one game versus Naventic.
You couldn't see the health bar.
No.
It was very scary. But I think he had a Sundering helping him out too there. Trying to get away.
Yeah. The Sundering from Goku is what really sealed that deal. Next pick here for Tempo Storm. What are they going to lock in? Will it be that Zagara that KO plays so very often? We've seen them shying away from it a bit. And not as valuable map for Zagara now. Oh, the Sonya pickup. You see how the meta is shifting throughout this tournament, where only Naventic was prioritizing Sonya at the beginning of this tournament, and everyone else was all over Thrall. They loved Thrall, and now day two, this has completely changed. We've seen so much Sonya.
So many teams have honed in on making sure to get Sonya early on in the draft. Rhaegar and Sonya will be the choice for Tempo Storm, and will be a little bit until they have more left. Cloud9 now with two picks of their own. We could see a potential support if they don't want to get denied one going into the next set of bans. More damage too, or even a warrior if they don't want to lose out on potentially getting a ban on one of those, and then Tempo picking one of those up. Falstad going to be one of their choices here.
Falstad, I mean, in K1 Pro's head, he's probably the best Falstad in North America. His Mighty Gusts are always on point. The sustained damage he has, I mean, K1 is so good at positioning. I mean, he had so many good plays yesterday, I believe, versus that set on Blaze, where most Falstad would have just died, and he was able to get away and get a good gust off. Murden's going to be the next pitch. I mean, King Caffeine, this is like a hero that he owns. Like, we've seen King Caffeine do the Leoric avatar with his face. He could do the same thing with Murden.
Yeah, and Murden's going to be really nice at pickup versus the Sonya once you get that Wrath of the Berserker. Man, I've been struggling with that one all day. Reverberation will be a help with that one as Meriden. We will have that for Cloud9. Now, the next set of bans, Tempo Storm could still ban a support here and limit that pool. Or there might be something else that they are concerned about. What do you think?
Well, they're going to go ahead and ban out the Morales. They are going to target ban that support. Dunktrain having one of the better Moraleses. I mean, actually, overall, I think North America, when it comes to supports, they have the most depth when it comes to Morales play. There are so many good Morales players here in NA.
Right. Yeah, we've seen a lot of good Morales play. I mean, even in the last match, we talked to Iacona about playing Morales versus Upheaval for Cho'Gall, which is never something I would do, but he made it work. Now, Cloud9 with a ban of their own. Could we see maybe Johanna? Tempo has been playing a lot of her as of late.
Tassadar.
Oh, Tassadar. Of course, Tassadar
Sonya.
With the Sonya. Yeah.
You have to deny the Tassadar Sonya Rhaegar. Just a little bit too much sustain. Tempo Storm in the next two picks. What will they lock in here? Could it be Cho'Gall? I don't know. I think I really dislike Cho'Gall on this map.
Yeah, there's just, especially when you get to the triple ultra phase, you have to have so many people everywhere. Trying to deny, trying to pick them up in that later game fight.
Probably Jaina for sure.
Yeah, I'm surprised she's made it through here so far. Zagara, yep. So KO on one of his trusted but most favorite heroes to play.
Yeah, his Maws have been a little bit off point on this tournament. I think he's whiffed quite a few throughout this event. So hopefully, you know, he's able to clear his head from his games from yesterday and able to come in today with a little bit better Zagara play, because yesterday it was very unimpressive.
So Zagara. We've got Goku for Sonya. We have Zix playing Rhaegar, so we're still looking at Shrey as well as Soldier. I'm wondering if they will choose to get their warrior here, if that's a concern. With Cloud9 already picking up Murden, they might be okay to give that up until the last point, not really being concerned with that getting taken from them.
Last pick here for Tempestorm in this rotation. What are they going to lock in? They need a damage. They need a true tank. I would not like to see Leoric here. We've been seeing a lot of Leoric today. Some solo warrior from Tempestorm. We saw the Leoric Sonya earlier as well, which I'm not too big of a fan of, but it is going to be that Lunara. So a lot of damage on the end of Tempestorm. A lot of siege. This is a...
Yeah.
This is a lot of siege.
Yeah, super siege mode from them. Cloud9 now have their last two picks. They're going to need to lock in a support of some kind. Morales and Rhaegar both off the table. Uther here, but we've seen usually when Uther is picked up, it's in conjunction with the Sonya. But we also have Brightwing as a potential. You know, Dugtrain plays a great Brightwing. Kharazeem.
I don't know if I like Kharazeem. I'm not a big fan. I think I would like to see... So this is something that I actually talked to with Kenma backstage. He asked me, you know, did you catch, you know, why I went hard and focused on Uther? And I was like, no, I didn't see that. Hard and focused, Kenma goes Uther versus Lunara and goes hard and focused on it over Benediction at 16. Mm-hmm. And it allowed him to heal through the Lunara damage. Normally,
yeah.
Uther is the worst hero to go against Lunara with, but because of that hard and focused pickup, I don't know how many supports are practicing it, but Kenma made it look fantastic yesterday. The first support I've seen do that. But it will be the Tyrande. I'm wondering if it will be solo support Tyrande. If it's not, I wonder who's going to play it, because K1 Pro, a big fan of both Falstead and Tyrande.
I was just thinking... We have not seen Tyrande solo supports, really. So I'm wondering if that's going to be the case.
Thrall,
it is. So Dunk is going to play Tyrande, Thrall to round out the composition, making sure they have that good melee assassin to help with the front line. Also have a good solo lane hero to deal with the Zagara, go toe-to-toe with her. Finally, who will be the warrior for Tempo Storm? Do they have something up their sleeve?
Has to be Johanna.
Or is it going to be more Johanna?
I mean, Stray's played a lot of Johanna, so I think most people are expecting it. But with this much CC, Iron Skin is so important. You got Muradin stuns, Tyrande stuns, and then Thrall Root and stuns. You need that. I think it has to be Johanna.
They're just considering all of their options. It's such an important match for them, and they know that they're up against a great-looking team. Cloud9 looked great in their earlier match today versus
Blaze. Stitches.
Ooh, Stitches
coming
out to play.
I like this. Stitches is actually really good versus this composition. It doesn't matter who you hook, Muradin, Thrall. The Tyrande does not have a lot of heals to keep someone up through a lot of bursts when that hook comes out. So really cool drafts from both these teams. Oh, man, but I think Cloud9's playing their game this draft. I mean, they've got all the heroes that they love. You know, it's a little bit of a slightly out of meta as Arthalon makes a ridiculous face.
Oh, Arth, you do entertain us. But yeah, their composition looks good. It will be just the solo Tyrande support, though, so they will need to be very mindful of that. But they have so
Arthalon's
much damage.
Oh, playing Thrall. Maybe that's why he was making that face. It's going to be iDream on Li Ming.
Oh.
We're changing it up. Arthalon move into that melee assassin role for this game. Okay. We did see Thrall played by Arthalon quite a bit, as well as King Caffeine in some of those really weird drafts they had earlier in the day. But, Cloud9 really showing their flexibility when it comes to what heroes they play.
Well, here we go, guys. These are the rosters. And there we do see iDream playing Li Ming. Arthalon showing us his flexibility as a player, that he can be on that Thrall. Everything looking very standard for Tempo Storm, but we are getting into game number one on Towers of Doom between Tempo Storm and Cloud9, our semi-final match, the first of two that we will have to determine which teams move to Seoul, South Korea for the Heroes Global Championship.
Here on the left-hand side of the map in the blue trunks, it's gonna be your world champions of 2015, Cloud9, representing them to their team with that mount. King Caffeine playing Muradin, Arthalon playing Thrall, Dunktrain playing Tyrande, iDream on Li Ming, and rounding out the teams, K1 Pro on Falstad.
K1 Pro can't even use his own Cloud9 mount because he is on a bird. But in the red, we have Tempo Storm with Goku playing Sonya, Sray, of course, playing Stitches, Zix on Rhaegar, Soldier playing Lunara, and finally playing Zagara.
Wow.
It's going to be KO. And look at that poll.
88% in favor of our world champions. And no surprise, through the North American qualifiers, they were one of the first teams to qualify. They looked fantastic. And throughout this tournament, they have been playing extraordinarily well. I think they've only dropped one game this entire weekend.
Yes, they did drop one game to Blaze, but otherwise were able to defeat NAM 2-0. So looking, like you said, very strong, but there's still plenty of time for you guys to cast your votes. So tweet using the hashtag HGC and the hashtag of the team name you think will take it.
So we'll be the Owl build from Toronto. Pretty standard when going solo support. We see this very often. It'll be Seasoned Marksman on Falstead. K1 Pro likes to change it up quite a bit. He goes between multiple towns out Tier 1.
Everything else, very standard. I'm not going to be Cruel Spores to allow Lunar for that little bit of extra push, but Natural Perspective is always really nice. It can actually help you be able to secure some kills, but speaking of kills, Sray in some trouble,
wow,
taking some damage, is going to be able to move back in time, making sure that no First Blood just yet.
No First Blood. You gotta respect that Hunter's Mark. Gilly does so much extra damage there. Dunk Trade showing the value of Toronto. Yes, she's kind of out of the meta right now, but we'll see how she's going to do in this game. How much Toronto have we actually seen this weekend? Is one or two games?
Yeah,
it hasn't been too
much.
Many.
Yeah. Maybe an interesting spot to see her in, but they're still going to try to make her work. I mean, the early game potential from Cloud9 is very good with her in the Mirrodin, too. They've got a lot of crowd control, a lot of damage, but the first Alter spawn will be happening very soon, just 26 seconds, and it will be a solo one down in the bottom.
Good scout with the Owl from Dunktrain revealing that a gank was rotating top as Stitches, Lunara, and Rhaegar rotated to go gank Thrall. So nice job utilizing that Owl from the Tyrande here. And I love this positioning from King Caffeine, K1 Pro, and Dunk Trade. They are ready to catch anyone out of position.
You know, Pierce is going to be so nice, too, once Cloud9 gets to level 4, that nobody will be able to block those Sentinels from coming in. Goku on King Caffeine just a bit, taking some shots also from KO and was poisoned, so already down to half health as both the teams move down into this altar.
iDream already at half HP just from that little bit of poke from Zagara and from Lunara. iDream trying to get in range. Nice body block from Goku, and the first altar is going to go over to Tempo.
Pretty easy pickup there. Great job, but the Lunar Flare comes down in 6 in so much trouble. Rhaegar will be the first blood of the game.
Nice turnaround there. Really good focus fire. I mean, it was a snap decision, and all 5 members turned around from Cloud9 to focus down Zix. That was just showing the synergy that Cloud9 has as a team.
Yeah, they're actually right next to us, and immediately, as soon as the Lunar Flare went out, we heard Rhaegar, Rhaegar, Rhaegar. So they were ready to just turn as the team, be able to get that first blood. But Tempo Storm with the first altar pickup. So both getting a little bit of something out of that fight.
Okay, well, it's going into level 5 here. We'll see what the team want, what these teams want to do here. Sray going to be in the mid lane, rotating top with Zix and Soldier, going for another gank on this top lane, but K1 Pro seems to be not aware of it. They're coming in here. Barrel roll hasn't been used. He's waiting for the hook to come out. He's being patient as it had a really weird hook in the back from Sray, knowing how bad he goofed that.
Maybe he was wondering if he was going to barrel roll in, but either way, he just tapped the gate and then came right back. But now, Sentinel will spot out the Tempo Storm is working on these Pumpkin Sappers. As well as how far down it was, but also just making safe that they could pick up these ones bottom. Yeah.
Take a look at the bottom lane here. That is there's a lot of creep so far from KO. Let's see, you know, how much that vision is going to help Tempo Storm this game. They have a lot of vision on their end with the Lunara Wisp and the Zagara creep. They're going to be able to see the rotations, which is really good versus the Miranda that we have in this game.
Yeah, similarly, we will have Sentinels, but that will be the main vision providing as it comes out once again to check and just see, make sure that they are indeed where they think Tempo Storm are, and they will pick up their Pumpkin Zappers, work on taking these ones out as well. Next, Alters will be spawning in a few seconds. 7 almost here. I'm wondering if we'll see follow through come in for Thrall with the Chain Lightning talents. That's often a big pickup there, being able to have that increased damage. We'll have to see 7 being picked up just now from both teams.
Thrall and Sonya finally rotating down, it seems, and really not seeing Cloud9 utilize that split soak from Falstead. What do you see?
Frostwolf's Grace.
Oh, wow.
So activatable to give extra heals. It makes a lot of sense with the Tyrande solo heal, trying to help their sustainability. Hook goes down, pulls Arthalon in. They have the Earthbind Totem trying to slow people down. King Caffeine has to jump out. Goku is on top of both K1 Pro and Arthalon, zoning them out.
A lot of damage on the end of Cloud9. Tyrande struggling without that Shadowstalk. She doesn't have that AoE heal. But a little bit of misfocus fire there on the end of Tempo. But nice job using the Pierce to interrupt KO. He's trying to get the cap. Bottom is still done. And look at Lunara zoning out iDream from going bottom. And that's going to be potentially the altar going here. K1 Pro going for one more interrupt here. He does hit KO. They're going on the Goku. They're doing a lot of damage. And now Cloud9 is collapsing. The Lunar Flare connects with 2 members here. King Caffeine comes from above. Misses the Stormbow though. Goku turning on the King Caffeine. A lot of damage go out. Hook misses iDream. And that might be the death of King Caffeine. Goku Falco needs one more slam, but he does get pushed back by the Thrall.
Arthalon needs to be careful, though,
wow,
as they're trying
damage.
To slow him down. Yeah, Lunara causing problems already for that Charanda heal. Li Ming will get taken out by Tempo Storm. There's still an Ultra left in bottom, but Tempo did lose the,
yes.
the mid one to Cloud9.
Cloud9 was able to cap that, but they're going to lose the bottom one. One more Owl's going to come out. Nice juke from KO, but Soldier will be the one with the cap, and that is going to put a slight advantage in favor of Tempo Storm when it comes to core HP.
There goes the shots onto Cloud9's core and moving back into the lane, trying to get close to those heroic abilities and pick those up. Tenderizer going to be the choice for Stitches. That will be movement speed slows from his basic attacks. And guess who they have on their team? They have Lunara.
Yep, Lunara, so good at this. I mean, this is such a great synergy right now so far for Tempo Storm. We see the creep spread moving up, Wisp moving out to scout the potential invade from Cloud9 here. Just really utilizing, again, the vision they have. They have so much vision on this bottom half of the map. At the same time, in the top lane, Thrall being collapsed upon by Sray and Goku. K1 Pro has to barrel roll over the wall.
So you're mentioning Lunara's split damage, and she actually picked up Splintered Spear at level 7,
Ooh.
Which once she uses Noxious Blossom, it actually means her next basic attack hits up to 3 targets. So that's where we're seeing instantly.
Wow, great body block from Cloud9
wow.
as they take down Sray.
But that's where we saw her be able to throw poison onto 3 different people at once.
That is really cool. That is actually an change, and I like it. You don't need the additional siege damage on this map. You're not pushing keeps. You're not going for core. You know, there's not too many merc camps to contest, so
yeah.
I really like this changeup from Soldier.
Yeah, and it's going to make it things even more difficult for Toronto to try to heal. I mean, she does have battle momentum as well as the power, just trying to make sure that she has her cooldowns up as much as possible for the heals, but the later this game goes, I worry about that heal.
Cloud9, the first team to hit level 10 here, taking a look at the heroics. I dream using Disintegrate to clear away. But it makes such a short cooldown. Why not, Gilly?
Yeah, 20 seconds. You might as well. We saw a little bit of a siege coming in from Tempo Storm toward that bottom fort bell tower. But as soon as Cloud9 hit 10, they started to move off. It will be Mighty Gust as well as that Disintegrate, Sundering, Avatar, and Shadowstalk for Cloud9.
And on the Tempo Storm, everything looking normal as well to see where this team fights are going to go from here. Cloud9 hasn't been able to force too many fights. They've been getting picks, and here they go. Great body blocking Stray. The stuns come out. He pops Putrid Bile, though, to kite back, doing a great job of disengaging for himself.
Maybe he gets the hook in, throws it out, only gets a minion, though, and that will be most likely the end of it as Cloud9 are able to disengage from that. Now, the next Alter phase has started. It's going to be one on each side, so we'll see if either team is able to stop the Disrupt, and the Sentinel stops KO from grabbing the Alter.
Hydream trying to get enraged. Good body blocking coming out from Tempest from Disintegrate. Use the interrupt again. Still, Cloud9 with the advantages. They did cap theirs. They get the hook, though, onto King Caffeine. He does Dwarf Toss out there. And this is really bad for Tempest Storm as Goku is zoned very far above.
Yeah, Soldier chasing down iDream into the bottom, trying to get the enough poke down that maybe they could force Cloud9 to have to give this up, staying together to make sure that they can keep up with those chain heals. But so far, Cloud9 not being willing to give this up quite yet.
Looks like Tempest Storm going to go tap well just to be able to reposition himself. KO going for the cap. One more Owl should be coming up sometime soon. Will KO get the cap, and he does Disintegrate, not there in time.
And that will be a trade on both of the altars, which means that Cloud9 is slightly behind in core health than Tempo Storm, but ahead in experience and moving back up. It's been so nice for them to have that false out, that global presence, so we can get right back into lane whenever needed.
Really great shot calling from Stray when it came to that double altar. Tempo Storm could have had the option to invade, but since they know they're 4 HP up on Cloud9, going for a trade is the safer option, as if you do go 1-for-1, you're still ahead in the game.
Yeah, it's just like Sky Temple. When you're ahead on structure, you're okay with just trading out when there are 2 temples. K1 Pro potentially going to try to steal these pumpkin sappers away from Goku. The rest of the team, some of the team moving in there, Stray and Zix there to try to help. K1 Pro going after Sonya. Will they be able to get her? King Caffeine comes in too. Mighty Gust pushes her into the wall, but Ancestral Healing is there.
Great juke on that Lunar Flare. That would have been really bad. Shadowstalk's been popped very early. Temple Storm seems like they're going to give this up. But there's a big push from KO and Soldier in this bottom lane. That's going to be that fort definitely going down. I don't think iDream can stop this.
Yeah, they still have the pumpkin sappers
oh, wow.
too, but Disintegrate does so much to them. But now it is done, and they still have a couple left to run into that fort. And with that, it should be just about the end. Being careful of iDream, but there's a few minions left to be able to take out the first bell tower of the game. Maybe.
So low. Is that actually not going to go down?
It's so low.
Wow. That is very low in HP. And iDream almost dying to minions by itself. Okay, so the fort still stands. That's actually probably a good thing for Tempestorm. What they can do is wait to just go tickle that down, and then when the altar spawn, they'll have a fort advantage, meaning they'll do more damage per altar.
Tickling to death does not sound fun, but it will be a great advantage for Tempestorm if they can get that. Cloud9 almost to level 13, so a good half level lead over Tempestorm, especially with Tempo not able to get the experience from that bell tower. Goku in a lot of trouble.
There's Regan taking a lot of damage. He's tries to spear out of there. A lot of damage going on. Great body box from King Caffeine and a nice kill. That's actually a really good pick here at this timing as the Shrine is spawning. They're going for Zix. Dream with the Blink Fort, but they're not going to be able to get him. I think Tempestorm has to give this altar up, but they do take that fort, meaning that Cloud9 will do one less damage with this altar.
Yeah, it's really nice that they were able to secure that and get away safely for the rest of them.
Sundering comes out,
and it might not be so safe. Ancestral healing immediately, but a great Maw from KO.
The Ancestral and the Maw were so perfectly timed. Dunk Train has to kite back. That saved Zix so well. The combo there between the Maw and the Ancestral was just perfectly timed.
Dunk Train still working to pick this up, should be able to do so, but it will only be three shots, like you said. So that is great for Tempo, and it does mean that Cloud9 have to eventually respond to picking up that bell tower, even though they have been able to eke a little bit ahead. But we're going to once again have a fight. K1 Pro uses the Mighty Gust to get away.
Soldiers going for the chase. Nice jukes from K1 Pro. Not enough, though. Soldier showing the power of Lunara. A nice kill there from Tempo.
Man, I really thought that he was going to be able to get away with the jukes. It was great to be able to dodge that Thornwood Vine. But now they're starting to work on the bottom bell tower. Tempestorm going to try to defend this as long as possible.
Oh, the lot of damage on the Dunk Train, and he's going to go down very quickly, body blocking Arthlon, and suddenly three members of Cloud9 are dead.
Oh, and that's great. They've been able to defend this too, which means they still get the maximum amount of shots. And look, they're trying to guide these Pumpkin Sappers into the base. If they can get those to the line, that means they will get extra shots onto the core of Cloud9.
Well, it is pushing in. They're going to try and get this fort back here. They're going to go for mid as well. This is great sieging from Tempo Storm here. Taking a look at the hero damage, I just want to take a quick peek at what Lunara is at. And she's at top, just barely ahead of Li Ming by 2,000 damage.
We do have unfair advantage, so that's going to be a lot more.
In.
There goes a hook onto King Caffeine. They're underneath this fort, but iDream is stuck between so many members of Tempo Storm and gets taken out. The fort goes down. I hear yelling as Meridian gets taken out too, and Tempo Storm is so excited.
Yeah, really, really sloppy fight there from Cloud9. It looked like the Gust was going to be good, but it was 3 versus 5. They pushed them under a fort, which wasn't even targeting the Tempo Storm members. And, you know, the Ancestral was used shockingly early from Zix, but it doesn't seem to matter. And now Tempo Storm doing a great job with the siege on this map. They're about to have another fort down. Yes, Cloud9 reclaims a bottom, but Tempo Storm, this just is so good for them. Any altar they get does more damage, and any altar Cloud9 gets does less.
Yeah, this is Tempo Storm showing their prowess on Towers of Doom, even without the Vikings. They have constantly kept Cloud9 now on the back foot, just responding to whatever bell tower has been taken out by Tempo Storm. As soon as they see them there, they move in and take another one, making sure that they are dealing more damage. And if they do lose a team fight, then making sure they don't take too much damage at the same time. Beautiful play from Tempo.
Well, level 16 to level 16, we're on the same tier now. Let's see what Cloud9 ends up picking up here. It's going to be the missile build, Gilly.
It will be the magic missile build. Once again, we have Mirror Ball to add 2 Charge Blast and Seeker. And with that Glass Cannon, lots of shots coming out. Sentinel just a bit too late, and that's 5 damage onto the core of Cloud9.
Looks like they're wanting to reclaim this bottom fort here. And this is what happens when you get a lead on Towers of Doom. It turns into this kind of silly rotation war where you go to recap your fort. Well, guess what? They're going to push your fort in. It's so hard. You have to force a fight and get a big win to be able to, like, stop this kind of pressure.
Yeah, Tempo Storm in a really good spot here, making Cloud9 beyond the response always on the back foot. And that's what you want to do in Heroes of the Storm, especially on this battleground. Already, I love Sray in the mid, pushing out this minion wave too. So if they see Cloud9 show up into the bottom, they start to push in on this lane.
Yep, and that's what exactly happened. Li Ming and Dunk Train show themselves to that creep bottom, and they're pushing in this fort. But K1 Pro looking for that flank again. And this time, all 5 members of C9 are here, and Tempo Storm, they're not going to play with it. They back out.
Fishing Hook has been picked up by Stray, so it is a potential for them to get a nice long-range hook if they can do so. Still leaming in the bottom, which means Tempo are not giving up this siege just yet. They picked up some Pumpkin Sappers in the bottom too, and once again moving back into mid with these minions.
It's half HP here. Stray taking a decent amount of damage with good heal so far from Zik. Hook goes down onto Arthlon. He takes a lot of damage, half HP, and a good Maw in the back line there. Does Tempo Storm have the follow-up? This is a big Avatar pop. Mighty Gust has been used, and Arthlon looks like he'll be able to disengage. Creature Battle doing a lot. Stray gets hit with the Ancestral, the last last second, though. Caffeine getting very, very low. Gets a Dwarf Toss out. Will he go down the poison? And that's going to be a death on Rhaegar. Good play from K1 Pro.
And that gives the resets for Critical Mass, and Cloud9 are chasing down the rest of the members. Goku gets taken out straight, very low. There comes the fly from K1 Pro. The hammering trying to stop Zagara will also get taken out thanks to the disintegrate once again from Li Ming.
This is a huge, massive win for Cloud9. Not only are they going to be able to get double alter, but they were able to reclaim all of their forts.
Yeah, that's exactly what they needed. They finally broke this hold that Tempo had over them. They're ahead a full level now in experience.
Oh, is this going to be a 1v1? Arthlon versus Soldier. Arthlon taking a lot of damage. He's slowed, and I think Arthlon's going to go down. He's got the win for. He's trying to get away, and he just barely survives.
Ooh, that movement speed really coming in handy there. He definitely needed that. But now King Caffeine gets hooked in. Was able to Dwarf Toss away. But now the first altar starting to be picked up here from this double altar spawn.
Yeah, it's going to be 4 damage to the core of Tempo. Storm almost evening this game up. But with Dunk Train capping bottom, for the first time, Cloud9 is going to have an advantage in core HP.
Uh-oh, Stray in trouble, has to use Putrid Bile to get out of here. They were trying to take the amount of shots that would come from this bottom altar away, but weren't quite able to pick up that mid bell tower. But again, it's one of those situations where it's so low that Tempo should be able to rotate in at some point and pick that out right before an altar phase.
And Tempo Storm showing their understanding of this map. They're not afraid to go back to the base and use the tunnel to try and reposition themselves whenever they need mana or just, you know, come back into this fight. So really cool use of this very unique mechanic on this map.
It is cool, but that tunnel can also cost you,
yes,
if you teleport in at the same time as some of the members of the other team, because you do share that outpoint. But now all of the struggle from Cloud9, they always are on their half, really, because of the constant siege from Tempo Storm. So they are going to likely hit 21st. Yeah, they're just about to pick that up. But the siege is everywhere, and Lunara doing a good job of helping those pumpkins into that bottom fort.
Well, Soldier's in a lot of trouble. Gus and Sundering both miss. Ancestral connects, but I don't think it matters. Ooh. That's a very dead Lunara. 2 heroics with, but it doesn't even, you know, Lunara's so squishy. She dies anyway.
She got deleted from, like, half health, and that's really big. Cloud9 being able to capitalize on those level 20 Storm Talents just in the nick of time. Haven't even picked up all of them yet, but knowing the minute they hit that, they needed to make something happen. That was the one advantage they had, really, as the constant siege from Tempo Storm has been a lot to deal with.
Nice exchange here from Cloud9 getting that bottom 4, but at the same time, in the top lane, Goku has been pushing in top lane. Falstad is flying up to deal with that Stray kiting back, taking a lot of damage, actually. He already half HP. This from Falstad. He has to pop Putrid Bile very early. Mighty Gust comes in. Here comes King Caffeine. Misses the spear. He has to reposition himself. Stormbolt comes out. Shadowstalk has been used. Stray doing the best he can to keep himself alive. Maw only connects with one target, and I think they just have to let Stray die. They cannot save him.
Yeah, Stray is just going back and forth, trying to maybe juke as much as possible, delay this for as long as possible, too, and does do a good job. Uses
the great escape.
Devour. Yeah, where he can,
this is such a bad time for Stray to get picked for Tempo Storm as a triple altar spawns, Gilly.
Triple altar is so tough to deal with. Now Zix is in the bottom, and Sentinel does not stop him there. The flight came down, but Rhaegar should be able to pick that up. He does at least get one, but it's still only 3 shots to 5. And with 2 for 1, yeah, all of a sudden, for the first time, we're going to have Tempo Storm way behind in their core health.
Down 9. If there's this is so tense for Tempo Storm. They have to be careful. Zix taking a lot of damage. Hunter Mark is off, though. They go for the Gust, and they're isolating him. Zix gets the Ancestral at the last second. Dunk Train pop sprint to reposition himself. Shadowstalk's going to get the kill on the Rhaegar. Goku's overextended. Whirlwind, disintegrate slow, helping out a lot. Nice Lunar Flare from Dunk Train, and Goku goes down as well.
Oh, the body blocks from King Caffeine, and the slow from Temporal Flux at 20 for Li Ming were so huge. 3 people down now. 2 people for 50 more seconds for Tempo Storm. And Cloud9, from what was a really tough hold on them earlier on, have completely turned this game around.
And they're looking to escort these minions into this bottom lane as well, it looks like. If you get the cap into the range of that core, that's free damage on the core as well.
Looking at the Storm Talents that we have, it will be Hunter's Swiftness.
Wow, Lunara, rip.
Oh, once again deleted from this as they are going to try really hard to escort these pumpkins, and they just need to get rid of these minions, and
there
one,
we go.
Three
damage to the core of Tempo Storm. That puts them at 8 life on the core. If there is a double altar, if they can get more minions in. Oh, nice hook on the iDream, and he gets, oh my god! iDream, he does go down to the poison from Stitches, though.
Oh man, that was too close for comfort for Stray, but he does pick up a nice hitdown on iDream now. Going after Falstad,
but Stray is getting so much damage onto him.
He gets caught out, and this fort is going to go down at the same time. Will Stray
body block, he's pinned.
Oh.
He can't get out of up here. Great collapse from Cloud9. Good heals from Zix. The Ancestral connects, but I don't know if it matters. Cloud9 Pro has to fly out of here. Arthorn being collapsed upon as well. Here comes Sonya. Nice Lunar Flare and a Sundering over the wall from Thrall.
Oh, man, I don't think that they should stay in this. Goku's still trying to make something happen, trying to trade out one for those kills, but they just have to let them away. The fort finally starting to come back up.
This could be game. It's two forts are down. If they cap both of us, Cloud9 will win the game. Tempo Storm with 47 seconds on Sigils. I don't know if it matters. Yes, 22 seconds on Idrip. Goku's going for a big spin. Hunter's marked on him, and he gets annihilated instantly. And I think this is game, Gilly.
Yeah, they had nothing to do. They knew they had to go in. Otherwise, they were just going to lose anyway. They lost Rhaegar. They lost Sonya, losing people earlier on, so they could not contest those final shots. And even on the battleground of choice, Tempo Storm not able to take a game off of Cloud9, but they're not out of it yet. It is a best of three, and they still can come back in the semifinal series.
I love the decisive decision-making from Cloud9 late game. They really pulled it together. They were struggling in the early game, but once they started getting their momentum in that match, it was just pick after pick after pick. Just really perfect gameplay late game from Cloud9.
You could hear it in their comms too, right?
Oh, yes.
The minute they broke
we've heard all weekend.
Yeah.
They're being a bit ridiculous, to be honest.
The minute they broke out of that siege, it was like the volume just was turned up us here. Like, they just started yelling and were yelling pretty much throughout the rest of the game. Anytime they found somebody out, they were just screaming.
The adrenaline, it's got to be intense here. They just got a 1-0 lead and a best of three on Tempest Storm. And if they win this next game, they're going to Korea. They need to defend their world championship title. This is going to be the first world championship of this year. They won BlizzCon. They want to be at Korea so they can defend that.
And can you imagine still even just getting to go to Korea as well? How amazing that's going to be for the two teams who get to represent North America, as well as the rest of the teams from around the world who will be representing their regions. It's a great honor to be able to do so.
Absolutely. And Cloud9, a team that definitely deserves to be there. I mean, through time and time again, roster changes, meta shifts, they have maintained the top two position in North America throughout all of 2015, and they're looking to continue that into 2016.
Well, Tempo Storm will have to change up their strategy if they want to be able to take out Cloud9 here in the next game, take it to a game number three, because they will be on the battleground of choice for Cloud9.
Yes.
Looking at some of the battlegrounds they've picked, Cursed Hollow has been a lot. That was their most picked one in the stat sheet. Also, a lot of Sky Temple from them in the qualifiers.
Yeah, it's really bad for Tempo Storm. They lost on their map of choice. You know, you do see very often that Tempo Storm likes to go to that map to try and get, you know, an easy win. And they lost, Gilly. This is really bad for Tempo. I mean, Cloud9's got a lot of momentum. There is iDream.
Look at that
he
grin.
Is the only player to win the 2014 BlizzCon and the 2015 BlizzCon. He is a star player for a long time. People consider him the best player in the world.
He is such an amazing flex player. And here we have Soldier on the side of Tempo Storm. Soldier, been one of the original members of Tempo Storm from last year, too.
Even dating back to Symbiote Gaming.
Yeah, he's been on this team, this roster, for a long period of time, making the switch from Warrior from last year to now playing
the Assassin. Yeah, he's playing the range of flex. Yeah, he's really showing his diversity. There is Dunk Train, the Beard Man himself. So glorious, and probably one of the best supports in the world. You know, he's competed on multiple stages. He's been to PAX. He's been to BlizzCon. He's spent multiple months in China. I mean, these guys are world-class players, and they are showing it in their play.
Yeah, and no one more so than K1 Pro, too. I mean, his false step play was on point that last game. Terrifying assassin to ever have to go up against. His flanks are unreal.
Yeah, K1 Pro might be my favorite player in the entire world. I'm going to be honest. I love that guy. But, guys, here's the draft for game number two. Cloud9 up 1-0, and this is their map. They got to be feeling good with Tempo Storm having that first pick, first ban.
Sky Temple now, if we saw Falstad in the last game, and he's going to be even more important, but Sonya will be the choice of ban. Look at the from the start of this tournament to now a first ban potential for Sonya.
That's the fun thing about these kind of high-class events that
we'll see
throughout all the regionals is the meta shifting throughout them. It's definitely fun to watch.
Yeah, it's always really fun to see which teams can adapt to each other in those metas even faster. Arthlon getting a little surprised, maybe, just keeping himself awake, something. But Cloud9 now with the ban. What will we see them take away from Tempo Storm? You know, Zagara is a really big pick for this battleground specifically, but also for Tempo Storm.
Zeratul going to be banned out by Cloud9. Tempo Storm with that first pick, first ban. Will they go for the Rhaegar again? Zix has had a lot of success on this hero this weekend. Or will they go for the Li Ming? I mean, iDream looked terrifying. Let's just be real. He looked terrifying on Li Ming.
Yeah. It'll be the Rhaegar.
It'll be the Rhaegar. Cloud9, well, I'm curious. I think it'll be Li Ming Falstad.
It could be.
K1 Pro, a great Falstad player, great on this map. Li Ming's damage is absolutely insane.
Mm-hmm. Both of the, and, I mean, that combo worked so well for them.
Yes.
They had great play for it, but
Li Ming,
it's going to be Li Ming Thrall.
Okay. Arthlon been playing surprisingly well on Thrall throughout the history. Me being someone who's spent a lot of time with Arthlon, throughout his history as a Heroes of the Storm player, he's never really played Thrall. I mean, when he was in the option to play that melee flex role, Thrall was not in the meta at all.
Yeah.
Well, the scaling changes brought him back, and despite that, Arthlon showing his versatility as a player, he can pick up anything and look fantastic.
Well, yeah, it's great pickups for them too, going into the fact that, you know, it'll be two picks and then two bans before they have more. The fact that they've got a really good solo lane hero in Thrall, they've got Burst from Li Ming, and then just a lot of damage in general from both of the heroes, too.
Jaina being picked up this game. I believe she made it through the entirety of last draft unpicked, unbanned.
She was.
So Temple Storm going to lock her in. Next pick here. Will it be a warrior? Potentially denying the Muradin from King Caffeine, as that is a terrifying hero in his hands.
They have to consider who will be in the solo lane. Versus most likely Thrall, that's a solo lane hero. But it will be Muradin that they grab.
Smart pick. I like that pickup from Tempo Storm. Guaranteeing a laner in this this map isn't as important. You're laning till about level 4 to level 7-ish, and then it's just constant rotation. So winning that early game in one of those lanes isn't as important as on a map like Dragonshire. So picking a Zagara right now is not necessarily needed. It helps. It's really good versus the Thrall, but not needed on this map.
Fair. Cloud9 now with a ban. They have the next picks after the ban phase. So it's potential that they could grab something, but I really like how Tempo Storm has set up their draft thus far, because they can't really be isolated on any of the really big roles, as they have some damage, a warrior, and support. It looks like Cloud9 just want to make sure they don't have to deal with a Cho'Gall here.
Last pick here for our ban here for Tempo Storm. Could potentially look to deny a support.
Mm-hmm.
I believe last game Tempo Storm banned out Lieutenant Morales.
Yep, but they still were able to make the solo Tron to work.
Yes,
even with a lot of damage dealers. So
that's a play style that Cloud9 has been running. Dunk Train, King Caffeine have been playing together almost as long as Soldier and KO. And, the original Cloud9 was running a very burst style with, like, Falstad, Nova. You had the Pursuing Strike, the Hinterlands Blast. And Taronda was used in that style. You know, King Caffeine and Dunk Train are used to using those, abilities, the stun lock, and to just annihilate targets very quickly. So, Taronda definitely an option. Falstad going to be the ban here for Tempo Storm.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. The global presence is really helpful, the fact that he can fly in later on, soaking the lanes as much as possible to provide a little bit of an experience lead, and also just the fact that he can get onto temples a lot faster by flying in to be able to pick those up should they be able to get to maybe win a team fight.
Well, next two picks here for Cloud9. They need a warrior, and they need a support, and potentially more damage. Gray Mane still on the table. Lunara as well. Lunara not as valuable on this map. There's a lot of running around, and not having a mount can make you a bit slower to those team fights. So we'll see what they want to pick. They've been putting iDream on a lot of interesting heroes lately. He's really diversifying himself as a player.
Ooh,
there it is. Wow.
Illidan.
That is not something I expected. Is it going to be Illidan Tass? Is this going to be solo support Tass?
Is this going to be another no warrior comp?
I don't know if I like this. This is really interesting.
Okay, so
because if they go for a true support, they then miss out on the Tassadar, which would hurt. If they go solo support Tassadar, that would hurt, and they potentially would have to give up a warrior. I think they have to just go a real support and then a real warrior.
So they picked Illidan into a Muradin too.
Yes.
That is risky.
That is very risky. Muradin does really well versus Illidan.
Mm-hmm. With Reverberation build. One more pickup. Is it Tassadar? Is it a Karazim?
Karazim. Okay, so maybe it'll be Karazim Tassadar. Now, Tempest Storm, very unlikely to pick Tassadar here. Illidan is a direct counter to Tassadar. It was a mistake made by teams throughout a lot in 2015. They would see the Illidan get picked up and, like, we can't let them get Illidan and Tassadar. We have to deny it. Pick the Tassadar. Illidan just, destroys Tassadar. There's nothing a Tassadar can do versus an Illidan. So really unlikely to see Tempest Storm pick up the Tassadar here.
Well, they're going to need a lot more damage, and we'll see what's on the table. Lunara is still here. You said you didn't like it as much for her because of a restriction on her movement speed. Other ones who are up for grabs, we haven't seen a lot of Rainer. Have we seen any Rainer this tournament? Like one, I think?
Yeah, we've seen him once or twice. I don't know how much I like Rainer versus Illidan, another hero that just kind of Illidan just runs over.
Yeah.
It helps when you get Bullseye, but...
Yeah, it's a long road.
It's a long road.
To 16.
That. Yeah.
Especially on Sky Temple.
Look how hard Tempo Storm's thinking about this. Mm-hmm. This is a tough decision to make. This is a really tough draft to draft around Cloud9. I mean, mad props to this draft. This is tough. Tempo Storm thinking very, very hard. They got to be running out of time soon. And it's going to be Abathur Johanna. Okay.
Okay.
Double Warrior Abathur. This is weird. Sylvanas, what? What is happening?
Oh, it's going to be a fun game, Zoya. I can't wait to see these drafts versus
again,
each other.
Cloud9 on Sky Temple running a warrior-less game. This time it's going to be Li Ming, Thrall, Illidan, Karazim, Sylvanas going up against... Wow, these drafts are very interesting. Even okay. Arthlon looked a bit confused.
I think everybody looks confused there, but...
It's okay. I'm confused for both ends. Soldier's like just staring into space like, I can't believe we drafted this.
Sorry, also contemplating life at this point, what exactly is happening in this game. But it's going to be a lot of fun. You know, Jaina is a great target for Ultimate Evolution. So that was probably a big consideration
yes,
for Tempo.
Absolutely.
That they were able to have Abathur. I mean, also Abathur Illidan was always a potential.
I think they're wanting to deny it.
Yeah, denying it.
I don't know
it.
If that was good, though.
You don't know if maybe they were looking to actually pick that up?
No, I mean, they were obviously going for it. But is denying the Abathur worth it in this situation?
You have two Jainas. So that you can do damage with them during the fights, but what's very interesting to me is the Murid and Johanna. I guess they just want to be able to have as much control as possible as tanky targets.
Yes.
Limit the targets who can actually get like flanked and taken out by that Illidan as easily. Make sure to keep them off of Jaina, but it really is going to come down to if they can keep Thrall and Illidan off of Jaina.
Well, here are our compositions. It's going to be a very interesting game. Arthlon playing Sylvanas, guys, but we are loading into game number two here on Sky Temple. If Cloud9 wins this set, Gillyweed, they will advance to Korea, the first North American team to do so. Tempo Storm, they have to either win this or they are out of the tournament.
It's going to be so close for them, but with awesome compositions from both sides, game number two on Sky Temple with Cloud9 in blue. K1 Pro playing Li Ming, Arthlon on Sylvanas, Dunk Train playing Karazim, iDream playing Illidan, and finally, King Caffeine once again showing us that tank Thrall.
And on the right-hand side of the map, in the red trunks, it's going to be Tempo Storm. KO playing Jaina, Zix playing Rhaegar, Soldier on Abathur, Goku playing Muradin, and I believe Shrey on Johanna.
Right, starting to move out. I'm interested to see how the Abathur build will work. It looks for now, it's going to be that Toxic Nest build, as it is Envenomed Nest, picked up at level one. Looking at some of the other ones too, we are gonna have Barbed Shot from Sylvanas, so really helping with the wave clear for her, being able to just push out those waves and siege a lot more effectively.
We did see, I believe, Arthlon play Sylvanas earlier today. I don't know if it was on this exact map. I'll have to look at the drafts again, but just showing the value of Sylvanas on this
wow.
map. They recently buffed tower damage, but doesn't matter when you have a hero who can disable them. That first tower goes down very, very quickly.
It's right here with an Abathur hat, but still the problem is the damage is done. They were able to get that full tower now, and with that starting to move back out into the lanes. The rotation from Cloud9 already starting to come in. They're going to keep Sylvanas in the bottom and just look to see if they can catch anybody out of position, potentially, especially because, you know, they've got a route, they've got the potential to take someone out if they can.
Now keep in mind, Cloud9 did a very similar composition. I actually want to find the draft so I can look at which heroes for heroes it was, but they lost this. This was the only map they've dropped on this in this tournament here at North American Regionals, and it was the Team Blaze doing this very similar style.
Yeah, once again, they're right back in action with Sylvanas. Tempo Storm had rotated out of the lane looking to respond to the mid, but instead find them going back for the bottom. So a lot of mind games coming out from these teams. KO has to get back behind the wall. Will be able to do so. No first blood just yet.
Arthlon trying to haunting wave away. Stormbolt goes down on top of him. Will he end up going down? Good heals from Ductrade, but first blood going to Tempo Storm. They're trying to fall back. iDream going for KO, but not willing to dive underneath tower. Shrey taking a lot of damage. Good use of the Abathur hat to try and keep him alive.
Great job by Tempo Storm responding, but they still did lose nearly two towers in the bottom. That could be an issue for them in that second temple phase when it's at the bottom. But for now, the first temples have started. Li Ming holding top. That's kind of a tough thing to do as Li Ming, by the way. So Rhaegar, we may see him start to move in there. But in the mid, we've got a fight going.
Well, they do end up holding this shrine up here. The collapse from Tempest Storm is happening. Zix potentially going for a place, but Arthlon scouts it out. Good mind positioning so far. And Cloud9 backs off the point.
Tempestorm gonna start holding this cautiously. Both teams trying to make sure that they get level four. That this, remember, the split soak from Abathur will be great throughout this, all the way in the bottom. He knows that everybody is going to be up top and mid trying to deal with that tempo phase, so he can feel pretty free about soaking that bottom lane.
Top lane being controlled by Cloud9. Middle's almost out of ammo here. Zix and, you know, Abathur doing the best they can to soak as much experience. And because of this, Abathur, like you said, full level lead so far for Tempestorm. Middle is about to be out of shots as Goku gets the last of those. How far does Cloud9 have to go? It looks like Tempestorm is looking to contest top.
iDream was spotted out by the nest by Soldier. Soldier cautiously staying in that tempo.
Oh, that Storm Bolt was so good from Goku. K1 Pro getting so low, and he is going to fall.
Yeah, Abathur, you cannot underestimate.
Wow,
it does so much damage.
I cannot believe he predicted that blink. That was so well done from Goku, man. Just showing you how often these guys play against each other. You know, what, you get to the point where you can predict their movements. I mean, keep in mind, Cloud9 and Tempestorm, they scrim each other all the time.
Tempestorm going to finish off the top temple, and Abathur was forced back out of that such aggressive position by iDream coming down into his lane. So now both teams going to start working on making sure that they can get the lanes, continue soaking, make sure that they can get level 7 before that next temple phase, which will be in the bottom.
Almost level 7, Tempo Storm getting very close. Cloud9 just about to hit 6. Haunting Wave using the scout into a bush. Good job from Arthlon. Just to be as mindful as possible. And these mines are so well placed. And K1 Pro reveals himself taking a lot of damage. Stray comes in and scouts out iDream. They're going on top of each other. Abathur's on top of Stray. Here comes KO and Zix. The Blizzard goes down and iDream gets so low.
This is a great invade too, because of the fact that they know they almost have level 7. Cloud9 just has to give these up. These giants will be stolen by Tempo Storm. They can rotate around and pick up theirs as well and be able to get a nice push in bottom. Make sure that the lane is fully pushed out, so once that next temple phase spawns, they have a better positioning to go, to be able to grab it.
Level 6, almost level 7 here for Cloud9. Tempestorm having about a full level lead right now. Bruiser camps being started by both teams as King Caffeine starting the bruisers in the top left, whereas Zix is taking out the ones in the top right.
Looking at the talents we have thus far, everything looking very standard. Cloud9 about to pick up level 7. We have the Immolation on Illidan, which is the big one, because it allows him to be able to solo camps a lot easier. And with these giants that were picked up, Tempo Storm getting a good siege onto these bottom towers, trying to do as much damage to the structures as they can, in hopes that if they get that bottom temple, they'll be able to take out the fort.
Really starting to like this Abathur pick here from Tempo Storm, showing its value. I mean, Soldier repositioning himself constantly. They don't really have good heroes at finding Abathur, you know, like a Zeratul or someone who can go and pick them off very easy, as they are very, very squishy. If they get overextended, they can be killed off. So, you know, abusing Abathur on this map seems to be working out so far on Tempo Storm, but, you know, Abathur, you know, you can play around him. If Cloud9 can adapt their play to the late game, they can really shut it down.
Thrall is going to pick up follow through, was thinking on it just a little. Wasn't sure if we were going to get Frostwolf's Grace once again, if it would be the follow through this time with the Chain Lightning build, but looks like Cloud9 are the ones who want to take out the bruisers of Tempo Storm. They know that they can push in toward that top fort. It's already pretty low, and any amount that you can get done to the fort makes it harder for Abathur to feel safe in pushing out, so it pushes them back further and further if they can take this out, especially as they know that that's where Abathur's going to want to be sitting, is top lane, because the bottom is where the temple is.
Well, good push from Cloud9, but it gets stopped as they did not have their Karazhan with them. They are moving back in with this four-man push. Tempo Storm's very split right now. Normally when you see something like this, you split push as a team, but because Goku, Zix, and Abathur are up here defending, maybe Jaina has to come up for some damage. They're going in for the kill, but the fort is going to go down.
Fort gets taken out. Can they get the slow on a dunk trade?
They have heroics.
Radiant dashes out. The heroics are there.
Not going to get
but
it.
Yeah, it's going to be. They're really good at timing for Cloud9 to be able to get that and disengage immediately. It was a small window before Tempo got those heroics.
Great shot calling coming out from Cloud9. Yes, they're down about a full level right now, but they are even on structures with that play. Just really well, really well done from them. They're going to get 10 very, very soon here, and that's when they can start contesting these fights a little bit better. Illidan is very weak until you get Metamorphosis.
So both teams now have taken out a fort. Mid fort is low, so the Tempo Storm does have the structural advantage for now. Stray trying to maybe catch iDream, does have that symbiote, which does a lot of extra damage. The Condemn comes in. KO and Zix are rotating around. The Water Elemental comes out, and Illidan gets taken out.
Still no heroics. They're so close. Goku goes for the stun on top of Dunk Train. He tries to get the Radiant Dash, but it doesn't matter. Two kills quickly going over to Tempo.
Excellent Condemn to make sure that they could get that second kill onto Karazhan just in time for the heroics to come out from Cloud9. It's always a really bad feeling to lose some heroes just as you get the talent tier and caught back up.
Taking a look at the Hurlix here for Cloud9. Nothing out of the ordinary. Again, Metamorphosis is a big tier here for Illidan. Another one will be level 13 when he gets that reduced ability damage.
The big question is if it'll be seven-sided Striker Divine Palm, and we do have Divine Palm play. Whoa. Wailing Arrow
comes out. Goku gets hit with a big Ancestral. Idrim gets the Metamorphosis on multiple targets, but he gets blown up almost immediately. Where is Dunk Train for the heals? They get the shield on the last second. I think Cloud9 can't fight this, though. Blessed Shield comes out. Condemn going down on top of King Caffeine. They're retreating as well as they can. Stormbolt comes out. Soldier on that Avatar Clone doing as much damage as he can, but not going to be able to secure any kills.
No takedowns. It was nice for Cloud9 to be able to get away from that, as well as Tempo Storm. You know, Cloud9 came in with the Wailing Arrow. They were ready for the fight with those heroics. So good job from both teams being able to disengage from that without losing anybody. But the big story is all this time, Abathur split pushing his little heart out, his little worm heart, and from that, nearly level 13.
Full level lead still for Tempo Storm. I mean, doing a great job utilizing Abathur's Soldier, soaking as well as he can. You see him using the symbiote in the top lane just to get a little bit of extra experience here. Sray gonna be nearby as well. It's gonna be a double shrine spawning, one in the top and one in the bottom.
13 almost here for Tempo Storm. We'll see what they pick up from that. If we're going to have Ice Block from Jaina, or if we're going to go for Icy Veins, she could feel pretty confident behind the double warrior, but it looks like they still want to have the Ice Block. Especially, it makes a lot of sense, too, with the dive that's potentially there for Cloud9 with the Illidan and the Thrall.
Goku looking like he wants to get a little bit of aggressive down here. He's looking for Arthlon Dream and Dunk Train. He goes for the Dwarf Toss, dismounts them. Water Elemental has been used. iDream has no real escape. Nice stun going down the Karazim and iDream, but nice palm at the last second. He Radiant dashes back. Can they survive here? The slows from KO doing so much, and Dunk Train's going to fall.
And the symbiote always on point on the front person to be able to make sure that they could get that extra bit of damage needed to burst somebody down. Tempo Storm with that picks up level 13 talents up top. Stray disrupting K1 Pro and King Caffeine from this top of temple. Meanwhile, in the bottom being held by Murd. And I love this double warrior composition that they're able to disrupt and be at both of the temple phases at once.
Oh, K1 Pro and King Caffeine getting slowed by Avatar Mines. Blessed Shield comes out and two easy kills going over to Tempo Storm. King Caffeine kiting away as well as he can. But you're not going to survive this, sir.
Nope, they will go down to the Condemn, and with that, more of these shots going over to Tempo Storm, holding both of these.
All three forts down now.
Yeah, I just love this double warrior that they have that Tempo Storm has picked up.
Goku getting collapsed upon, though. Will they be able to force him off of this? And they easily do. Yeah, he does not want to mess with that. He's hiding in the bush, doesn't end up Dwarf tossing out. Maybe looking to re-engage here as KO is here. Rhaegar a little bit behind. He's trying to get on the point to force them off, and yes, it looks like the last of the shots, did they get it? Cloud9 did not get it, and a lot of damage actually going on the Dunk Train. He Radiant dashes out. Zix going for the Earthgrass Totem. Does he have one more dash up? He gets stunned. Nice palm. Can he get to the iDream? iDream looking for the reposition, but no, Dunk Train's just going to go down. iDream was just a little bit too afraid that if he repositioned himself to get closer to Dunk Train, he would put himself in danger as well.
Yeah, I think the call was just to leave him there. Make sure to lose just one person instead of potentially both, but with this constant aggression and great job of being able to force Cloud9 back, Tempo Storm finds themselves up two levels, especially thanks to that Avathur split push too. Soldier's been all over the battleground.
Are doing work to Cloud9, scouting out the invade and forcing Cloud9 to boss the back off. The bottom keep has already taken some a little bit of damage from that shrine, but now this boss is going to do even more. And suddenly, a two-level lead for Tempo Storm as they're just about to get 16 tier.
Tempo Storm bringing the battle to Cloud9, especially on the battleground of their choice here, picking up the boss. They have this great push that'll go into the bottom lane now too. Avathur has been pushing everywhere at once, and they're about to pick up level 16 to level 13. 14 about to be there for Cloud9, but this is a large window of opportunity for Tempo Storm, and they are taking advantage of it.
Well, you do see this boss and Giants pushing down here in the bottom lane here. See how much damage they can do with this push. They want to get the keep. I don't know if they can. This is really a lot of damage with this composition from Cloud9.
Boss starting to move in. Cloud9 so far away from being caught up in talent tiers. Holy Renewal will be the choice of Johanna, making her even tankier. Goku throws out the Stormbolt, going up to K1 Pro, who has to teleport away. This will be the first keep of the game going to Tempo Storm.
It does go down, but the Tempo Storm overextend potentially. Soldier going actually really deep here for K1 Pro and King Caffeine on that Avathur clone. He will end up losing it, but the rest of Tempo Storm able to disengage because of that. Really well done from Tempo Storm.
Yeah, that was a great play there to force people back from that Jaina damage. By the way, we do have Northern Exposure now. So that plus two Jainas, that's going to be insta-death if they can lock somebody down.
Level 17 versus level 15 here. Tempo Storm still having that talent advantage, starting to take some merp camps. Cloud9 struggling to find where they want to go. Abathur Mines again revealing constantly where Cloud9 is as King Caffeine does get hit by that mount. And now we have a two shrine spawning, Gilly.
And the shrines are top and mid, which means it'll be bottom where Abathur can sit along with these giants if they don't get cleared up right away.
And look at the Abathur Mines here around mid. There are so
They're
many. Dunk
insane.
Train immediately ran into two.
And that's insta-tilt. When you run into it, it's just like, come on, 50%
yeah,
slow.
Yeah, slow is so annoying.
Yeah, and it's so it's 4 seconds. You're just like, no.
Cloud9 very split up here. K1 Pro in a lot of trouble. Bless Shield does go out. Water Elemental with a slow, and he's just going to go down very quickly. Dunk Train not having anything the Radiant dash to. Two quick kills for Tempo Storm here. And with these bruisers, I think they can get a keep. They don't even know to go for the temples here.
Yeah, I like that plan too, because that means that the temples will go on to the final keep. They're into the mid. They know that it's going to be a long time until the support is back up. Until Li Ming, they have to deal with that poke damage. And so they're taking advantage of that. Muradin, though, is holding on to the mid.
Wow,
they know that.
I Dream dying.
Wow.
That is really good for Tempo Storm here. Don't think they're going to be willing to go core. It's tough to push core without having, you know, that fifth body on Abathur and, of course, Muradin soaking mid. But this middle keep is going to go down here. 5 seconds on Li Ming, 7 seconds on Karazim. Temple Storm getting that keep basically for free. And with both these temples being up, Gillyweed, this could be a triple keep for Tempo.
Tempo is blowing my mind with this double warrior because they can be everywhere at once. They have Abathur soaking one lane, and then they can separate out and do two things at once. They have Muradin holding the mid temple because that's what's going to shoot the mid keep. They push top with Johanna. They still have a warrior there too, a good frontliner to tank some of the damage, and they take out that keep. And with now holding the top keep, they are going to make sure that all three keeps go down on the side of Cloud9.
And now they're very close to level 20, a 3-level lead, about to be 4-level lead, and Tempo Storm has to not fight this. This is the only opportunity Cloud9 has to force their way back in this game. They wisely get off that point, but this is such an uphill battle here for Cloud9. They're going in for this, though. The stun goes down on the Li Ming. Bless Shield comes out, Divine Palm connects, and Li Ming does reposition himself. K1 Pro still taking a lot of damage.
Water Elemental is trying to slow down the members of Cloud9 so that they can't get caught back up there. Soldier throwing out massive amounts of damage
wow.
on that Abathur's ultimate evolution, and the Illidan will get taken out yet again.
KO still alive somehow in the backline. Goku, Stray, and Soldier still looking for more kills. They get the stun on the K1 Pro. He is going to end up going down. Dunk Train's caught, and with four members down, the core is exposed. Three lanes of catapults pushing it in. I believe Temple Storm has done it. They have tied up the series versus Cloud9.
Every single series today going to game number three, and this is no different. I would expect nothing less from our semifinal matches. Tempo Storm showing a commanding presence on Sky Temple. Even with Cloud9 it being their battleground choice, they are showing that they are not out of the
30%, and that's it. The series is tied. We have a game number three.
Fantastic job by Tempo Storm, already cheering and yelling. Zix is so loud.
He is loud. He gets hypey.
That's awesome to see. And now they have the momentum going into game number three versus Cloud9, and that's a big deal to be able to have.
I'm really curious about that composition from Cloud9. I want to ask them about it later because they've ran it twice now. I don't know if it was the, do you have the draft written down from earlier where the Cloud9 played Blaze on that map?
I do.
But I'm curious if it's the exact same composition. Maybe they got some false positives from scrims where, you know, they had some success versus certain teams. They thought it was really good, and it's just not working in a tournament setting because they've ran it twice now, and both times it seemed a little bit unimpressive.
So the difference is they had Uther and Brightwing versus Karzeem, Sylvanas.
That's
and then,
right. That was
and
double support.
This time was Li Ming versus the false stat that they had before, so they had a little bit more control yeah. with that. But we are going to go to a quick break, guys, and when we return, game number three.
Born for the arena. On my squad, we trust the spirits for guidance. No one gets left behind. Not even a pink skin. And when our backs are to the wall, I call on the elements to even the odds. Names, Rhaegar. Heroes of the Storm. I am the Storm!
game number one picked up by Cloud9, but Tempo bringing it back in game number two, and now one game left to see which team will go to the finals and also to Korea for the Heroes Global Championship, Zoya.
And this is just our first of the semifinal matches. We still have Noventic versus Cognitive Gaming coming up after this, and then, of course, that grand finals. But this has been a very exciting game. Tomb of the Spider Queen will be our map, but Gilly, you just gave me an interesting stat. Every game today has gone to game number three, every set.
What an amazing day of Heroes.
Yeah.
That we have so many close sets between all of these teams, just showing the diversity of how many awesome Heroes teams that we have here in North America. It's been fantastic to see Cloud9. We see them here, their faces. They lost the last game, but they're used to this. They're used to losing a game and still being able to stay strong. How do you think they're feeling now, the mindset in there?
You know, stamina is a very important thing. You have to keep in mind, Cloud9 was the first team to play today. They've been playing longer than anyone, and as we get further and further in the day, if they make it to the finals, you know, you just have to start thinking about, are they getting exhausted? They've been playing for such a long time. So hopefully they can keep up that energy, that excitement level, because like you said, they're getting really hyphy over there. They're the closest team to the casting desk, and they are loud.
Yeah, they have been really loud, but it was last game, Zix, who was listening to.
He's across the room, and we heard him bark a few times. Well, here we go, draft guys. Game number three is Tomb of the Spider Queen, and immediately Cloud9 denies KO Zagara.
Yeah, Zagara makes so much sense on Tomb because of how much her vision from creep tumors can control or help a team control those turn-in points. Now, Tempo Storm, we've seen a lot of different bans. Sonya was their choice of ban last game, and Zeratul was number one in the first game.
Interesting. We'll see what Tempo Storm wants to respond with here. We've been seeing teams change it up quite a bit today.
Mm-hmm.
And it will be the Zeratul telling iDream no. No, sir.
Makes a lot of sense. I mean, Zeratul, his Void Prison is such a strong heroic. It can change a team fight, it can change games. But also on this battleground, there's so many places for Zeratul to hide, so many ways. It's a small battleground too, so it's really easy for him to move around and scout out, almost like a mobile vision ward. So those will be our bans, both of the Z heroes, believe it or not.
Both of the Z heroes?
There's only two Z heroes.
There's only two Z
Zagara
heroes.
And Zeratul.
What about Zarthus? Or
that's not
Zitches.
A thing. Okay, and Cloud9 with the first pick, first ban.
Yeah, they're thinking really hard on this pick. Do they want Li Ming? Do they want the Rhaegar?
Mm-hmm.
Who did they first pick last game?
They were second pick. They had got Li Ming,
oh,
but
right.
Rhaegar was picked up by Tempo. When they were first pick, though, on Towers, they still grabbed the Li Ming.
Yeah, thinking really hard on it. The K1 Pro did play Li Ming in that last game. I think he's played it in both sets. And last game, he just kept, you know, the good collapses, good hard engages from Tempo Storm, but a very different style of draft. So if they do want to go to Li Ming, I think they are very safe to do so. And it will be the Rhaegar, though, getting Dunk Train Rhaegar. I don't know how many times we've seen Dunk on Rhaegar this tournament.
Not a lot. It seems like they've been more willing to allow them to go, but we also just haven't seen a ton of Cloud9 games in general because of the fact that you know, they were the first one out of their group.
Yes.
So there's one less set of games for them, and then they also had a 2-0 versus Nom.
Goku looking so focused right now. Tempo Storm prepares their next two picks. A lot of damage on the table. Falstad, Li Ming. They could potentially look to deny the Muradin again.
Goku has been cracking me up all tournament with his ability to just stare
death
longingly.
Stares, they,
oh, I thought it was like a lovingly into
no,
the.
No, that's like I'm going to, you know, end your world. The scary thing is he'll be moving into the team house soon, and I'll be living with that guy.
You walk into the hallway, and he's there.
They're just, oh my God, you're scaring me. Quit. I'm tilted. This is it.
It's not a hard thing to tilt you, my friend. Still
very
waiting.
True.
It's going to be, I think, a long time between these picks. You know, they're going to take their time because of how important this game is.
Well, last time we saw Goku play Thrall on this map, I believe it was versus Panda Global. And he got picked like 8 times in the early game. It was a very sloppy game from Goku on Tomb of the Spider Queen on the Sierra. So we'll mm-hmm. see if he readjusts his draft.
Yeah, that was the one battle
or his play style.
They lost to Panda Global,
yes.
Actually. But if you can make it work, you know, there are some great places for a Sundering to really maximize and hit as so many heroes from the opponent's
team. Look
how
slow this draft is compared to the other drafts. These
yeah.
guys are thinking so hard, and it will be the Jaina. Okay. Cloud9 doing a good job, or Tempest Storm. I like this draft so far. Cloud9 with their next two picks. Let's see what they want to lock up. And Li Ming still available. Gray Maid, which both of these teams, I think we see Dream on Gray Maid once this tournament, and Tempest Storm hasn't run it at all. So neither of these two teams seem to be a big fan of Gray Maid right now.
Wave clear, very nice for Tempest Storm. They have Jaina. That is a factor that's always really important on Tomb of the Spider Queen. We saw Sylvanas in the last game. We potentially could see her again, although probably not Sylvanas with a Thrall Illidan composition.
I'd be really surprised if we saw Sylvanas this game. It's really interesting to see Sylvanas pop up, especially from Cloud9. Historically, Cloud9 has not been a team that runs Sylvanas too often. They stopped running her when she lost the ability to one-shot people, but Arthlon is a player who's been Sylvanas playing for a very, very long time throughout all of 2015, so maybe that's what he brought to the team. You know, he's the newest addition to Cloud9, and he brought a little bit of his style to the team.
Muradin will be the choice, and once again, we're going to have Li Ming for Cloud9, feeling very confident with the burst that she brings to the table. Now, Tempo Storm with a ban. I like, once again, that we have the first pick team having a support, a warrior, and a good damage dealer. It makes it very difficult to try to constrict a certain role from those bans.
Well, we'll see what Tempo Storm wants to deny. A lot of damage options. It's not very often you see Cloud9 run double warrior. If they were to ban a warrior, I would say Sonya would be the best ban here. I think I actually really like a Sonya ban right now from Tempo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, especially since there's Sonya and Talstar still available too.
Yeah. Oh, those would be brutal last picks. And there it is. There's the Sonya ban. I think it had to be that. Cloud9 with their next ban. They can look to deny support or a warrior. Force Ray onto a hero he's not so comfortable with. Mm-hmm. We see a lot of Joanna from him. They could also be looking to deny Zik something. Something that's good with the Thrall, Uther, or Morales.
Yep. I mean, Morales could be a huge problem. She's able to sit in the back line. They get a really tanky front line, too. But it's going to be Joanna for Ray.
Forcing Ray up Joanna. I like it a lot. Cloud9 really adapting their draft to the opponents they're playing against. Mm-hmm. You don't only keep in mind the meta, but you keep in mind who you're playing against, and that's where these things get exciting. So, really cool draft so far. I think both teams are playing this perfectly so far. You know, each rotation seems like the perfect picks. Next two picks here for Tempo Storm, they still need a warrior, they still need a support, and that last damage. Now, we've seen a lot of Leoric from Tempo Storm at this tournament, and to be honest, it's looked terrible every single time. But that is an option. Every time that Sray's been put into a weird... Oh, Woo! My gosh, there it is, the Cho'Gall. And this is with a lineup that we don't see very often. How often do we see Cho'Gall with Jaina and Thrall on the same team?
Not often. I think we've seen a Cho'Gall and Thrall together before. What I'm interested in is who's the support going to be for that? Morales? There's no Rhaegar.
It has to be Morales.
I think it's Morales, yeah. All right, well, before that, Cloud9 has two more picks left. Looking at some damage now. And do they force Cloud9 into the Leoric? They've already have a Rhaegar, so not sure if they'll be willing to do the Karazhan Leoric. There is Sylvanas.
Sylvanas. This is the third time this tournament Cloud9 has picked Sylvanas.
They picked it once here. And the last game, and then yes, they did pick it once versus Blaze, too.
This was the first time they're playing Sylvanas, a hero who Tempo Storm was running a few months ago. They were the only team playing her, and now Cloud9 bringing her back in the North American regionals. And really interesting. This is a really interesting style from Cloud9. We'll see how it works. I mean, when Cho'Gall was initially released, I talked to Dreadnought. We were trying to figure out what's the best way to play about him. And his initial ideas were to just out-rotate it, you know, push, split push as much as you can. Sylvanas is known for that. Anubarak, hello.
I'm so pumped for some Beatles.
Beatles are good. So this is actually pretty cool. They've got a lot of damage on their end. What they're going to be looking to do is web wrap either the Cho'Gall and get kills outside of that, or looking to web wrap the target, the support. To be able to actually secure that kill onto the Cho'Gall. It's really cool. It's not a hero we see often, but I really like it here.
He has received buffs fairly recently. Uther will be.
Now, this is an interesting situation as the cleanse has changed recently. Mm-hmm. You used to be able to pre-cleanse yourself to avoid a web wrap, and good supports got really good at it, at the denying web wrap, but you can no longer self-cast cleanse. So if Uther is wanting to avoid the web wrap, he's going to have to divine shield himself. which is not good.
No, that's not what you want to have to do. Now, Anub'Arak has received buffs fairly recently. He had an increase to the shield on Hardened Carapace, but even with that buff, we haven't seen very much of him at all. It's very rare, but this is something they're bringing out to try to combat that Cho'Gall.
Well, we currently have a 75% win rate, I believe, on Cho'Gall this tournament, as Karnov did give him his first loss in that set they played earlier today. Will Tempestorm be able to win with Cho'Gall? You know what? I think I have to give it to Cloud9. I really like their draft. I think that is a super smart draft. I know both these teams. They both spend all nights just studying drafts, like every possible option and every possible map. And I have a feeling that this is something that Cloud9 thought of to deal with Cho'Gall on Tomb of the Spider Queen.
This is really important. This is the final game in this best of three. So both of these teams bringing out everything to the table to make sure that they can win this and get to the finals and get to the Heroes Global Championship in Seoul, South Korea, which will be the next line in that championship. But here are our rosters, and it's going to be a Soldier playing Gaul and Sray playing Cho.
Yep, no surprise there. But guys, this is the last game of this best of three series. This is it. Winner of this game right here qualifies for Korea. Get excited, because we're loading into Tomb of the Spider Queen.
Here is Tomb of the Spider Queen, and in the blue, our previous Heroes of the Storm World Champions, Cloud9 with King Caffeine playing Muradin, Dunk Train on Rhaegar, Arthalon playing Sylvanas yet again, iDream playing Anub'Arak, and finally K1 Pro on that Li Ming.
And on the right-hand side of the map, it's going to be Tempestorm in the red trunks, KO on Jaina, Goku on Thrall, Zix on Uther, and it's going to be Sray and Soldier playing Cho'Gall.
Cho'Gall has been seen a lot in this tournament. It's been so great to see.
A little less one-sided.
Yeah.
A little less.
Bringing it back a bit with that win there for Tempo.
Well, let's see here what Cloud9 plans are doing. I mean, I love this draft. This draft is so cool from Cloud9. Anytime you see a Anub'Arak and Sylvanas in the same game, I mean, that is going to be a treat. Cho'Gall taking a little bit of damage here, but the turning surround on the Arthalon. Nice punish from Tempestorm to prevent that tower from taking much damage.
Now the big deal will be preventing the siege from Cloud9 for Tempestorm, because they not only have the Sylvanas, Li Ming throws out a lot of siege damage. To actually Cho'Gall getting in trouble here, going to be able to hurry up Oaf away. Just in the nick of time, throwing out whatever damage he can. But, you know, they really have to watch out for that siege, because Sylvanas makes a Webweaver phase so much more effective.
I'm curious as the mindset of both of these teams. Neither of these drafts are something that both these teams run very, very often. They're very different styles. They're very cool to see. And this is such a stressful game for these guys. It's so hard to bust out something new, this diverse, in the middle of this big of a tournament. But that's Heroes of the Storm. Every time we get a big tournament like this, the meta shifts to the most bizarre places.
It does, both trying to throw off their opponents in the games that are oh so important, bringing out all of the big strategies that they've been saving through the lower tiers of the tournament, making sure that they have those strategies to try to throw off their opponents. But looking at this, the rotations between the lanes, that's going to be a constant on Tomb of the Spider Queen, just moving up and down, trying to look for any picks you can, and also just pushing out those lanes as much as possible while picking up gems.
And something a lot of damage going on the Anub'Arak, but he is going to burrow charge out of there. Arthalon taking some damage as well, but they're going to get behind the wall. But something I just realized is Niventic has only dropped one game this tournament. It was the Tempestorm on this map versus Cho'Gall.
Oh, yeah. This is a big, hopefully a big confidence boost to Tempestorm that they were able to get this Cho'Gall.
It was a very different draft than this, as they did have Rhaegar that game. But, we talked to Iacona earlier after they beat their team Blaze, and he said that some things need to be there for Cho'Gall. And one of them, the first thing he listed was Rhaegar.
Yeah, and they don't have him. He's on Cloud9's roster, and that does mean that they won't be able to have him be as aggressive. You know, Uther does take he is very cooldown dependent, and with such a big health bar, it can be really hard for him to use those cooldowns to get Cho'Gall all the way back up. But he still does have the Divine Shield to help him get away if need be.
Well, level four here first for Cloud9, moving around the map, repositioning themselves as well as they can so far. Gems, only five has been turned in from C9, but the gem count very, very even so far.
Legion of Beetles picked up for Anub'Arak. Anub'Arak had his talent art updated recently, and it's gorgeous. It looks so good. I love it. I love that the art is constantly being updated. But both teams rotating down through into the bottom. Thrall might be in trouble. Has to try to get away where he can. The Root is going to go out on a Dunk Train. The collapse from both teams into this bottom lane.
Well, Cloud9 still maintaining that experience lead, about a half level up right now. Taking a look at the positioning from these teams, Muradin soaking top. As far as gems go, it's 35 to 32 in control, and 5 turned in from Cloud9. But Tempestorm sneaking in a lot of gems here, 27 suddenly turned in for them.
That's really nice to have those turned into. If you're worried about getting picked off, you know there's a lot of crowd control from Cloud9. You can continually try to turn in those smaller amounts instead of letting them build up, and that lets you feel a little bit more confident about getting out into the lanes and getting into those rotations too. So 44 being held on the bodies of Cloud9, but they were finally able to get some in.
Lost CC going down here is very, very low. He's trying to kite back. Good body blocking from Zix. The poison might be enough. Does Zix have enough time for one more heal? He's trying to get to the well, and he does tap it just in time.
Soldier now could be in trouble as well as Stray on that choke all, but King Caffeine will be the one shot who has to go back. Impale comes out, a root onto Anubarak, forcing out the Burrow Charge.
Still maintaining that half-level lead. Good job so far from Cloud9 as they're getting very close to level 7. When it comes to the gems, they've turned in 17 of their own. Tempo Storm does have enough for a turn in here, so if they can sneak in 13 more gems, excuse me, no, 23 more gems. They're just about to have enough more. Caster math.
It wrecks us all, my friend. Dunk Train going to get stopped by the Frostbolt once again. Cloud9 a little bit closer to level 7 talents, but it's only going to be a slight window. If they could try to get that, maybe they could get the turn in that they desperately are trying to get thus far. But so far, good job from both teams trying to deny that out, and neither getting really, really close to the turn in.
Well, Cloud9 just about to hit level 7
oh.
here. Oh, nice first blood going down on the Anubarak, but they're catching Cho out of position. He doesn't have much room to go. Cho'Gall gets the dash. Can they get to him? No, they do not. I cannot believe Cho'Gall survived there.
That's why surging dash is so important, as it does give you that extra range with it too. You can get further away. So that was a really big pickup there. May even see power surge picked up here. No, it's actually going to be I am hurrying. So not going to have that the increase or that lower cooldown for it to get charged up. But still a really good save there on Cho'Gall.
Really good job so far from both these teams. Both have enough gems for a turn-in. We're to see who the first team is to get that. Dunk Train trying to sneak in 19 gems down bottom, but does end up getting denied.
Look at level 7 for Li Ming. It's going to be Calamity build coming out. I could hear both of these teams that the comms are very tense. They know how important this is. They're really trying to catch people out of position. There's only been one death on so far throughout this game, Tempestorm being able to get that earlier kill.
Anubarak sneaking in 3 gems top. No, he does end up denying it, as they do want to get those off of Dunk Train. Like you said, when you're holding a lot of them, it makes it tense. And that's going to be the first Web Weaver of the game spawning for Cloud9.
Cloud9 will start pushing down. And remember that they have Sylvanas, so the siege is going to be even more terrifying from them for Tempestorm to have to defend. They're going to do their best to do so. Meanwhile, Cloud9 are already starting to push out these lanes where they can, making sure that the Web Weavers go as far up into the lanes as possible.
Well, let's see what they can do with this here. They still have a very slight experience lead. Tempo Storm in position to defend multiple lanes. We do see Cho'Gall has to sprint away as he was getting very, very low. The Li Ming Puck, I mean, K1 Pro has been bullying Cho'Gall this entire game.
Yeah, and with the Calamity build, she'll be able to do damage with that too. Oh, Soldier could be
stun.
In trouble.
Oh,
they stun them out of Surging Fist, and that's really big. He has 21 gems. Can he get out of here in time? Zix trying to come in.
Oh my god, that haunting way from Arthalon was so dirty, but now he's in an awkward spot. KO trying to get a kill. Goku catches him in a spot, so he will end up dying for that. But there's 30 gems on Goku. iDream dies for it, but does not end up getting the kill.
It's still a 2-for-1 technically because it's Cho'Gall, so a great pickup for Cloud9, and they're a full level ahead. Once they get heroic ability, they're going to feel so confident to continue pushing here. And they have Sylvanas pushing as well. Actually, they don't because she was the one who was taken out.
These are doing so much in the other lanes as well because there was a big fight that lasted a decent amount of time. Those Web Reavers have been uncontested. And out of nowhere, Cloud9 with a level and a half lead. They have their heroics. It will be the Web Blast.
With a first
Cocoon.
Yeah.
That's what it's called now. Been a while since we've cast this guy.
With the first Web Weaver phase, a lot of times you just get towers.
Oh,
this time they got
the bottom,
so
Gilly.
Much.
They're looking for, they get the web wrap on the Cho'Gall. The rest of the team is coming up. Zix is very isolated. iDream with the body block as well as King Caffeine. And they're going to try and blow up Cho'Gall here. A lot of burst damage immediately. He's at half HP. And Zix, I think, is just going to let him die.
Yep. Once again, Cho'Gall just had come back up out of the respawn and now is going to be down for 20 more seconds. Tempestorm still not yet with their heroic abilities. A 2-level lead for Cloud9. They got so much out of that first Web Weaver phase. 2 forts. And the third one is half health.
This has been such a great game from Cloud9. They are playing this perfectly. I looked at the draft at the start. I thought I was going to like it, and they are playing this perfectly. Their execution was so smart. I've seen taking a little bit of damage on this tower as he did get rooted by Goku, but Webweavers were turned in here. Goku did sneak in a turn in, so Tempo Storm having a moment where they're going to be able to reclaim some of the map.
Yeah, I love this because with Cho'Gall, since you have that high health pool, you usually feel okay with being out and pushing by yourself, but now, because it's such a small battleground, if iDream can catch him with the cocoon, that's 8 seconds where the team can completely collapse onto him and be able to take him out just like they were able to do there. So 2-level lead for Cloud9, but Tempo Storm does have a Webweaver phaser going to start to push back.
See what they can do with this, but that bottom lane is so far away with the Webweavers. Tempo Storm contesting this top fort, going to do as much damage as they can to it. Looks like Soldier and Goku going to rotate in mid as well, so doing as much split DP or damage as they can to soak as much experience, but looks like they might be wanting to pressure the Cho'Gall.
Now the siege from Cho'Gall is still very effective. They're trying to take down some towers, but the Webweaver is done. All of the heroic abilities are up, so they need to be careful of the cocoon. Still a little bit until we have Hammer of Twilight back for Cho, but it's a really short cooldown.
Not much was gained. They got about a half level closer to Cloud9, but they're still a level and a half down. Bottom Webweaver didn't even get to the fort wall, so this is an ideal situation here for Cloud9. But they're going for the stun on the Cho'Gall. A lot of bursts coming out from K1 Pro. The Storm Bolt is there. The Web Wrap goes down, and that prevents Zix from healing them for the time being. They're going to split their DPS. Healing Wave comes out, and that's going to be Divine Shield melee. iDream's getting very low. He's going to be the first to fall on this fight. Shadow Bolt Volley doing a lot of damage to Dunk Drain. Hunting Wave used for Arflon to reposition himself. Body blocking Dunk Drain as well as he can. Ancestral connects with them, but so far a good job from Stray.
Yeah, Surging Fist really good to try to get into the body blocks, but Ancestral Healing does save the day for Dunk Drain, but still Tempo Storm this time able to get through the initial cocoon problem that they had before with Cho'Gall. Great Divine Shield from Zix right out of the gates to make sure that he has it, but still, even with that takedown, they're still down to level 13, about to be grabbed just now for Cloud9.
It's a very hard decision for iDream to make. I don't know if the Cho'Gall was the right target, the Web Blast there. Let's just say you do end up web blasting Zix instead. KO's right on top of him to help burn that cocoon down, but KO gets cleansed right away by Zix. No kill onto him just yet.
They may have to change up their strategy once Cho gets Molten Block at 13, but until then, they are still looking for the fight.
Oh my god, they're about to get a big turn in.
Yeah, they have all of them turning in at once. They know that there's going to be no contest here. Only one fort remaining on the side of Tempo Storm. They could look to start putting some pressure down on a keep, especially because once again, they have Sylvanas.
Outside of that last team fight, Cloud9 is playing this close to perfect. They're still maintaining that 2-level lead now. They're starting to get a little bit further and further ahead. And with 2 forts down, with mid barely standing, and these Webweavers spawning, Gilly, Cloud9 could push this lead so far.
With Barb Shot and Splinter Shot coming in for Sylvanas, she clears out waves in no time at all, especially with Unstable Poison too. So they're able to make sure that all of the lanes are completely pushed up toward the base of Tempo Storm, so they get the maximum value of the Webweavers. They push all at once, so wherever Tempo Storm chooses to defend, the other lanes are pushing pretty freely.
We do see that the Webweavers are getting some value here in the bottom lane. That keep could potentially go down if it is uncontested by Tempo Storm. Cloud9 pushing in this mid lane. They are about to lose that Webweaver. Top is still very healthy as iDream is split pushing with that. And that split push is what's going to get them further and further ahead. And look at this Webweaver bottom lane as it's getting that keep, starting to siege it down. KO and Zix have to rotate to it.
Dunk Train starting to come up too. They have the Sylvanas so they can move in, stop the structure from attacking this Webweaver, force the members of Tempo Storm to come in. Through all of this, Tempo has still yet to hit level 13.
Yeah, they're still at level, not level 13, where Cloud9's almost 15 here. KO looking for the chase. Sundering goes out. They isolate 2 members there. Ancestral connects with Arthlon at the last second. Web Blast goes down, and they're trying to kill off the Thrall.
Divine Shield does save the day.
Oh my god, the surround!
Oh, and the silencing arrow too. Even with the Shadow Bolt volley, they take out Cho'Gall without losing anybody.
Oh my god, if they get one more kill, this could be game. The resets. They catch KO. The keep's about to go down as well, and Cloud9 can win the game right now. They're going for the keep. It's about to fall. They have 16 seconds on Cho'Gall, 19 on Uther, and 20 on Jaina. Cloud9 is going for the core. This could be it. This could be the first team to qualify for Korea.
Cloud9 still working on it now. Goku gets eliminated.
That's game.
It. Cloud9 will win the game, moving on to get to go to Korea, representing North America.
A 4-level lead. Cloud9, congratulations. They are the first team to represent North America. What a game. They played that perfectly. They drafted it perfectly. What a game. Wow!
Oh, I cannot wait to hear from these guys. The looks of relief and excitement that they're able to qualify, go to Korea, and also go to the finals too, where they may be facing a rematch versus Team Niantic, but we'll have Niantic versus Kognitiv, and we'll see who actually will be facing Cloud9 in those finals.
They I am so impressed with Cloud9. They saw the Cho'Gall strat on Tomb of the Spider Queen yesterday. They thought about what if that happened to us, and they prepared such an amazing draft, and they played that perfectly. Wow, Cloud9, I am so impressed.
I am so impressed as well, but TempoStorm played an amazing series, really doing a great job on Sky Temple, being able to bring it to a game number three, making our semifinals so incredibly excited.
You see KO and Arfon hugging there. I mean, they lived together. They spent all of 2015 and a good portion of 2014 as teammates, but you know, despite the rivalry, there's still the love there.
We're checking out some of the replays from this awesome game. As we get ready to
this right here, this surround was so disgusting, and we could hear them screaming, body block him, body block him, body block him, and then they just get this perfect surround on Cho'Gall and secure a very easy kill. And this right here is what snowballed it in their favor for a very decisive win, 12-minute game.
Yeah, it was so decisive. Cloud9 has to feel so great, but I want to hear exactly how they're feeling, Anna.
Dongjin, you and your team will go to Korea to represent our region and fight for the World Championship one more time. How are you feeling right now?
Oh, it feels really amazing to go back to the World Championship. I mean, North America scene was a lot tougher this round. A lot of the teams here just really stepped it up, and I'm super proud of our region. I'm so happy to be able to represent them in Korea.
There was so much strife this time during the draft, and I heard TempoStorm just saying, we have to pick Cho'Gall. If we don't pick Cho'Gall, we're screwed. Were you trying to force them into that pick?
Yeah, kind of. We knew that they really wanted to play that. So we drafted a comp where we felt our Cho'Gall was so scary that they would have to pick it or ban it. And when they didn't ban it, we're like, okay, it's basically a coin flip if they're going to pick it or not. So we just decided to leave it up and try and use the strategy we had been developing in scrims.
You seem very calm right now.
Not really.
Are you freaking out inside?
Yeah, I'm pretty freaking out.
I know the casters are freaking out too. Guys, do you have questions for Dongjin?
I have plenty of questions. First of all, you sound like you're losing your voice. You guys scream too much in your games, man. It terrifies us. We can hear it over here.
Yeah, how else are we supposed to defeat our opponents without using intimidating shout?
That is exactly right. Now, my question is, twice a day on Sky Temple, you've done a very unorthodox composition. Please, just please.
Yeah, we kind of messed that draft up. Like, the Abathur pick caught us by super surprise, and we were just absolutely hosed. There was really amazing mind placement props, so it was really rough to play. But yeah, we got absolutely wrecked by that.
So my question is, tell us about the Anubarak and why you grabbed that there.
It's kind of a strategy we've been trying out in scrims to some success. And basically, we were really expecting them to pick Medic as their support. And when you web wrap Cho'Gall, there's just no frontline to protect the Medic, right? So you just dive her and she instant dies. We picked Anubarak there and they picked Uther, and we thought it was still okay because they defended against that plan, but it made their comp overall pretty weak. It made them really reliant on killing someone on the all-in, which I don't really feel like is what you want your plan to be with Cho'Gall. So it was just really hard, I think, for them there, and I don't know.
Beautiful draft. That was insane. That was really impressive.
And we want to give you time to go completely calmly and quietly celebrate with your team backstage. But before you do, I want to know, you're going to face the winner between Noventic and Kognitive. Who would you like to face, or who do you think you're going to?
I think we have to say that we're more likely to face Noventic at this point. I mean, they looked just really, really strong in the group stages. So I would expect them to come out on top in the semifinals.
Well, we won't have to wait long to find out. And thank you very much for your time, Dongjin. Congratulations one more time. Guys, we are going to be back with that match very soon. So don't go anywhere. We have more Heroes of the Storm coming right up.